begin in northern Texas, where a series of rainstorms had pounded the area around Gainesville throughout the spring, leaving the land heavily saturated, the rivers and creeks overflowing. Most of the footage in this story was taped as the events unfolded on the afternoon of May 9th, 1993.
It was about as flooded as I've ever seen it.
We have a healthy respect for rushing water. I've seen water move out into the middle of the street in my town.
Around 11:25 a.m., an alarm sent Gainesville Fire Captain Malcolm Foster and firefighter Al Brule out into the storm.
We heard the call for two women stranded in a Suburban in high water. We thought we had all the right ropes and all of the right equipment that we're going to need, and we're going to bring these ladies back, and yeah, we're all going to get wet and have to take a shower when we get back to the station, but that's no big deal. Got on scene, it's a whole different story. This thing is raging, man. We've got this travel trailer on the back of this Suburban that was 4 to 5 foot deep in rushing water. There's no way that you can put anybody down in something like that because they'd be swept away immediately. To look at those ladies and see the fear in their eyes when they roll the window down and wondering what's going through their mind, I'm thinking they're going to panic and one of those ladies is going to jump out and try to swim out. And I know that they can't, not in this water.
Okay.
When a truck pulling a camper trailer was caught in a flash flood and swept off a low water crossing into a raging river, Fire Chief Steve Boone was called to the scene along with additional rescue units.
Due to the force of the water, the only way we figured getting to the victims was by the air. The closest helicopter area here is out of Dallas. We figured that's probably 45 minutes away.
So you have to write the script as the movie goes along. And we decided the best bet was to take ladder apparatus, extend the ladder to these women, and take them out using the ladder as a crane.
The design of the bridge, which was under construction at the time, was very narrow. And extend the ladder fully off the side of the truck is something that's not supposed to be done. The main concern was the truck tipping over. But we knew the time was very short and very critical.
Up on top.
What was holding them on the other side was a guardrail, so that could be washed away along with all of the other debris involved. And we would have a body recovery instead of a rescue. Captain Foster grabbed the rescue harness. I was at the controls of the ladder, and away we went.
Neighborhood resident Ray Russell had put in the first call for help.
I had a great concern for Captain Foster himself that he might not survive going into the Suburban, which was subject to being ripped loose any moment.
I get Captain Foster out over the Suburban. He breaks the back window out, goes into the Suburban, and attaches life jackets and life belts to these ladies, and brings the first lady out. Everybody's giving me the signal to go up. I'm already trying it. The ladder won't work.
The ladder was fully extended, which is a 75-foot ladder. And you put the weight of two people into that ladder coming off the side. Our outriggers aren't designed to carry that type of load.
The wheels actually came off the ground at one time before all these volunteers climbed all over the opposite side of the fire truck to counteract that leverage. My concern was that the whole crew and truck and everything might end up in the creek.
I was starting to get real worried. We decided to go to a manual operation, which is just a crank. As soon as we got the ladder moving, the hydraulics took back over, and we got the first victim out. I'm not liking it, but I know we got to do it again. Captain Foster gives me the thumbs up. I say, okay, guys, this is same song, second verse. The people around were noticing more guardrails, more pylons, more shoring material washing away from this bridge. So even the bridge that we were on seemed unstable. When we got the second lady almost back to the bridge, the ladder seemed to stop. Finally, somebody reached out and pulled them in.
After nearly an hour trapped in the rushing floodwaters, 76-year-old Marguerite Johnson and her daughter Judy Duncan were finally safe.
There was a lot of high fives and handshaking and pats on the back.
I am a veteran myself of 20 years with the Dallas Fire Department, and I have seen many brave acts. That was the bravest I've ever witnessed, that act by Captain Foster.
I really thought it was going to be a simpler rescue than what it turned out to be. If I'd had another option that I thought would work, we would probably tried it.
The Suburban and the trailer are a loss. My fire truck was bent up a little bit and scratched up a little bit, but that's okay too, just as long as they're out and they're okay.
Both women were examined and released without injuries. Judy then got a chance to call her husband, Carl.
One weekend a month, they go on a trailer trip. And she hadn't called or showed up. I kind of wondered where they might be. So I asked her, what kind of problem did you have? And she said, well, we had a little water problem.
Recently, Judy Duncan and her mother, Marguerite Johnson, got a chance to thank the men who saved their lives that day.
Hello, I'm Malcolm.
Well, I was wondering if I was going to get another one.
The water rose so quickly that suddenly it was just coming in under the door, suddenly front seat. I just knew when that fire truck came. No problem.
That everything was okay.
I liked it when Judy got out of the Suburban. She's carrying her purse. Well, where are you going to put this?
And I said, what?
She said, well, if we fall. And I said, well, if we fall, we're both going. You know, my guys, they actually rescued us instead of me rescuing the women.
When I took them up,
yeah.
I feel really grateful to them. I really do. And I just feel like somebody really made some split decisions that were very good and saved two people's lives.
We kept a lot of people busy that afternoon, didn't we?
Y'all were real fortunate that guardrail was sitting there.
I hope that I'm never put in that situation again, but at least if I am, I know the limits of the equipment, and I also know that I don't think there's any limits to the guys that I work around. Everybody was given all they had, and it worked.
Glad to be here.
Yeah, me too. You know, it's something that I guess all firefighters live for, because your heart's beating 90 to nothing and your blood's flowing real well. It's what I love to do. I love rescue.